we're going to do two case studies side by side, one on Africa and one on Ibero-America, of the British Empire in action. And some of the materials, particularly in the Ibero-American side, is new, so listen carefully. All right, first. This is a the document of the Trans-Aqua project for Central and East Africa, which was put forward by the Italian state energy firm ERI in 1990. According to this plan, a canal would have been constructed parallel to the River Zaire, and it siphoning off about only 5% of the entire water volume of that river. And that canal then would have gone north into the tributary of Lake Chad and then further to refill Lake Chad and to green the entire Sahel. This canal would have opened up 12 to 17 million acres of the Sahel to intensive cultivation. And even at that, even by only draining 5% of the River Zaire, that would have been double the amount of volume of water in the Nile River downstream of the Aswan Dam. The next two, please. Oh, no. It's the other way. Well, these are backward thing. No. No. Yeah. Okay, now can we put the puzzle together? Okay. All right. So this gives you a, this is a, the intersection of the canal with what was planned as a Lagos to Mombasa highway right across all of Africa at that point. And this is a drawing of what the intersection of these two projects would have looked like at the intersection of the Ubangi and Chad River basins. So this is what Central Africa could look like today if this plan had gone through. But that's not what we got. The plan was ironically approved by President Mobutu Sese Seko of Zaire and also by the President of the Central African Republic. But instead, in 1990, as the world's eyes were riveted on the Gulf War, troops of the Ugandan army marched into Rwanda and unleashed the most intense genocide of this century. Next. Okay, recall in your mind's eye now the enormous numbers of horror stories that began to pour out in the United States press beginning in the end of May of this year on the death of hundreds of thousands of refugees in eastern Zaire at the hands of Kabila, Kagame, and Museveni. But now for a minute, sort of step back from that picture that you can undoubtedly evoke in your mind. And think of that not as a horror perpetrated against strangers, but as a glimpse, a pulling back of the curtain, if you will, of your own future and the future of your own families if we do not set about soon to change the course of history. And in order to do this, it's very important to understand what happened in Africa and why. Next. This is a map of the population density of Africa, and you can see that it is, except for certain pockets of highly dense population, there really is, it is relatively speaking underpopulated. And even those areas of high density, there's no area that is anywhere near as highly dense, densely populated as Belgium, for example. So anyone like Prince Philip who says that the reason for what we're about to discuss is overpopulation is simply lying. The Trans-Africa project, the Trans-Aqua project, would have opened up that entire white area, of course, to all this incredible development. But instead of this, what was happening in Africa going into 1990 is that it was reaching the absolute limits of further extraction of loot under the normal conditionalities policies of the International Monetary Fund and the World Bank. Let's just take a look at that. This is the banker's arithmetic for Africa. This is a a heuristic device invented by Dennis Small. And let's take a look at this. In 1980, the debt was $135 billion for all of Africa. In 1996, the debt was $339 billion. But in the meantime, all the African countries combined had paid $175 billion in interest alone. So normal people would say, well, Africa has paid its debt. But bankers say, $135 billion minus $175 billion equals $339 billion, doesn't it? Next. Now, what did this look like in six of the African countries of East Africa? We'll take Uganda, Rwanda, Burundi, Kenya, Tanzania, and Zaire. The population of these countries combined is 132 million people. The total debt of these countries is $33 billion, or $250 per capita. Well, it just so happens that the annual per capita gross national product of Uganda is $250 a year. Now, if Uganda, what that really means is that Uganda, the great IMF success story, is completely bankrupt. What it means is that if everybody stopped consuming anything for an entire year and just worked in order to pay debt, then perhaps Uganda would be able to pay its debt. But in point of fact, 90% of the Ugandan population has absolutely no money at all. And if you were to hand them $250, they would feel very wealthy. So the fact is that there is no more money to loot in that old form. Even so, but as of 1992, the IMF conditionalities had taken their toll. Next. Okay. This gives you an idea of how many children died in the year of 1992 as reported, only those reported, in these six countries alone, and the total is 905,000 children, according to the United Nations Development Program. And for obvious reasons, the UNDP no longer publishes this statistic. That's a million children, practically, in six countries of the third world alone. And just imagine, you have a million, I was just in Brussels, and I understand it's a city of about a million people, so just imagine filled with children, but they all happen to be dead. And that's what we have from the IMF alone in East Africa. Next. And this is what we mean when we talk about the Africanization of South America. What we really mean is death. Because what has occurred is that from the 1960s, the life expectancy rose, and now in the 1990s, it has gone down in all these countries of East Africa. And in the case of certainly Uganda. Next, please. Rwanda, it has gone below what it was in the colonial period, before independence. Next. Rwanda is a special case. This is what began to be unleashed in 1994. And the population of Rwanda was probably close to 8 million in 1994, and is now estimated probably at the level of 3.5 billion. Now, who's the Grim Reaper? Next. I once talked to an Ethiopian-American member of the Congressional Research Service named Ted Dagny, who is a major booster of John Garang and Museveni in this country. And I said, why are you carrying out British policy in Africa? Why are you doing this? This is British policy, don't you know? Why are you doing this? And he said, it's not British policy. I said, well, yes, it is. It's because the British are the people who have the interest there. And he said, that's not true. The British have absolutely no financial interest in Africa. And he said this to me and believed, I guess because I'm an American, that I would believe this. But The fact is that throughout Africa, and particularly in the Commonwealth countries, the British banks, particularly Barclays and Standard and Chartered, are the major private commercial banks in the country. And any other bank tends to be a state bank, but all those banks now are being bought up and brought into the British megalopoly. And so this is where we stand economically in East Africa at the point really of 1994.
Approximately 6 years ago, in fact, in 1991, Executive Intelligence Review published a cover feature also published in our Spanish language publication, Resumen Ejecutivo, which said that the IMF was Africanizing Ibero-America. And this by way of warning about what was happening and what was going to happen if these policies were not changed. Now, mind you, the Africa of 1991 is not the Africa of today. Today is a far different situation, far worse, obviously, but we had a pretty good idea of what was coming, and we warned people that if the policies would not change, that is exactly what would occur. I also recall that shortly after publishing that report in travels in various countries in Ibero-America, I would pretty consistently and predictably run into the response from Ibero-Americans of shocked outrage. Well, how can you dare say that we're going to end up as badly off as the Africans are? I mean, you don't think we're that stupid, do you, that we're going to end up like that? And of course, when we told the Eastern Europeans that they were going to be Latin Americanized the same way that Latin America or Ibero-America was going to be Africanized, I remember very well having a discussion. It was right here in this hotel in this lobby. Some of you here may have participated in this or heard some of the yelling and screaming. It was with a couple of Ukrainian parliamentarians who were absolutely horrified that I would dare say to them that Ukraine would end up moving down the same path as Mexico or Brazil or Zaire. And they said, we're not a banana republic. And they weren't then. And of course, I had to explain to them what should be obvious. It's not that we are insulting or talking about the dignity of those nations. We're talking about the intent of the people behind the International Monetary Fund, behind the banks, the British oligarchy, the British Commonwealth, and their intention to Africanize the entire world. And the same thing will happen here if it is not stopped. So when you are looking at Africa, you are not looking at something that's happening way over there. How dare you say that something like that might happen here? It will happen here. It is happening here in the most profound way, as I hope you will be made aware, perhaps disturbingly so, by the end of this panel's presentation. If I could have the first slide. Joe, also, yours. This is the rough situation in Ibero-America in general terms. You're talking about 20 countries overall. You're talking about a total population of 485 million people compared to a substantially larger African population at this point. The foreign debt of all of Ibero-America is $657 billion, substantially larger than Africa's. And if you look at a number of the leading countries of Ibero-America, you'll see that Mexico and Brazil are in neck and neck competition over to which is going to have the largest foreign debt this year or this month. Right now, Brazil is ahead. They have $195 billion. Mexico is in a close second place with $180 billion. Although perhaps the more interesting comparison is to look at the proportion of the debt to the population or the per capita ratios. Linda told you the absolutely horrifying proportions in the six Central African republics she was talking about $250 per capita in debt. Well, in the case of Argentina, it's about $3,000 per capita. It's an order of magnitude larger in terms of the debt situation. The policies of the International Monetary Fund have wrecked Ibero-America over the last 15 years. They have brought it to a point of collapse of physical economy, which we have documented in some detail. The situation, however, that is coming down the line is far different than what has occurred up until now. Now, the upcoming Africanization is to produce levels of genocide and destruction, obliteration of the nation state, and above all, the bestialization of the human being of a sort which we have not seen until now. What's coming is new. Now, if you take a couple of just very rough physical economic parameters to compare Ibero-America, Africa, and also the United States, since I'm sure no one here shares any of the preconceptions or the prejudices that our Ukrainian friends shared, and was fully prepared to look at the prospects facing this country should we not turn this around. The foreign debt and population figures is as I had described them on the previous map. You can see that Ibero-America has a far higher debt per capita than Africa. In terms of land area, Ibero-America's land area is about 20 million square kilometers. Africa is somewhat larger, 28, 29 million, and the United States is 9.5 million square kilometers. If you take a look at agricultural production capability with one very simple parameter, grain output, grain production per capita, measured in kilograms per capita, production per year, you will notice that Ibero-America produces about 248 kilograms per capita, which is about one quarter of what is produced in the United States. The African level, however, is approximately half that of Ibero-America. If you look at manufacturing, which is of course a sign of the relative state of development or capital intensivity of an economy, the situation in Africa and Ibero-America both is particularly despairing. In manufacturing jobs per 100 square kilometers, in other words, measuring it in terms of the density of the land area as such, Ibero-America has 61 per 100 square kilometers. In other words, less than one manufacturing worker per square kilometer. The United States has 194, which we're not in very good shape, as everyone is well aware. This is about two per square kilometer. Ibero-America has about a third that level. Africa has one-third the level of Ibero-America in turn. So that gives you some rough idea of what we're dealing with here. Now, before you move that slide, the question of grain production is, of course, complemented in terms of consumption, availability of grain for consumption, by what an area imports. In the case of Ibero-America, approximately 15% of consumption is imported, in other words, beyond that production level. In the case of Africa, fully a quarter, 25% of its consumption is imported. Now, under conditions of the kind of world economic crisis that is now going on, with a complete collapse of the financial system, with no resources available for anything other than debt payment, you're talking about the situation where immediately you are reducing the imported component of food consumption. That is to say, you are reducing consumption by 25% like that. Consider what that means off these levels, and you get some idea of the straightforward economic aspect of the genocide. Next slide, please, both. This is called comparative banker's arithmetic. It doesn't make any more sense when you look at both together. In the case of Ibero-America, just quickly, 1980, the total debt was $259 billion. Over the course of the next 15 years, Ibero-America paid $488 billion in cumulative interest payments alone. As Linda mentioned, no amortization payments, no principal repayments, none of that is taken into account, pure interest. In other words, almost twice the original debt was paid. The debt was paid twice over. But of course, at the end of that period, the debt had grown from $259 billion to $657 billion, and you have your familiar banker's arithmetic of 259 minus 488 is equal to 657, and I challenge Bruce Director to explain that one.
Challenge accepted.
Bruce, how your voice has changed. Now, this process of debt looting is simply one feature, as many of you are aware, of the overall derivatives speculative bubble that's going on worldwide. This enormous growth of a completely fictitious value, as you saw yesterday in the triple collapse function, has grown completely out of control with no physical economy under it to sustain it whatsoever. That is, of course, what blew out in Mexico in December 1994. It wasn't a Mexican problem or a Mexican debt bubble. It was an international derivatives bubble which blew up in Mexico. And that same bubble in its different components is now blowing up in Southeast Asia. That's the problem in the Philippines. That's the problem in Thailand, Malaysia, Hong Kong, and so on and so forth. It's the same problem. Now, if we look briefly at the overall world debt situation in the next transparency, colors courtesy of our graphic staff, and a lot of people have worked on this for a while. The world foreign debt picture is really quite amazing. In 1980, it was $647 billion. It is today over $2 trillion, $2,177 billion. These are official World Bank figures, so you know they're an understatement. The red on the bottom is Ibero-America. The next one up blue is Africa. I wanted to indicate both of them to you because together, which is what Lyndon and I are talking about today, you're talking about a total of almost $1 trillion, close to half of the entire world, official world foreign debt figures. Now, as I mentioned before, and Richie, if we could have the next transparency, we're in a process of a phase change. What has gone on until now over the last 15 years of IMF rule is nothing compared to what began approximately 18 months ago. In the case of Ibero-America, in the beginning of 1996, very end of 1995, beginning of 1996, the process of financial bankruptcy as a result of the multiplier effects of the Mexican debt blowout and of the overall world financial situation effectively raised, destroyed the banking systems of every country in Ibero-America and left them open for the pickings. Well, the pickings came along very quickly. The banking systems were privatized. Every state sector bank just about was sold out, taken over by foreigners. And the situation today, according to our latest calculations, is in the case of Mexico, for example, 59% of the assets of the entire banking system are controlled by foreigners. In 1982, after Lopez Portillo nationalized the banking system, 100% were owned by Mexicans. They may have made mistakes, they may have had problems, but they were the sovereign owners of their own credit system within a very difficult world environment, but nonetheless, they were in charge, presumably, within their own borders. Not today. 59% controlled by foreigners. Venezuela, 41%, Colombia, 51%, Peru, 42%, and so on. You can see the general parameters across the continent is that about half or better of the banking system of every country is now run by foreigners, with one exception, which is Brazil, only 14%. And that tells you a little bit about why Brazil is particularly on the British target. Now, the argument here in all of this to achieve this was, of course, the standard neoliberal free trade argument, which was delivered by the likes of Adam Smith's followers and so on to the governments of the Third World, in Ibero-America in particular, where they said, but you must liberalize, you must open your doors, you must enter the new globalized economy. Why, if you will merely open the doors of your economy, all of the capital will come rushing in, and you will benefit greatly. And of course, they opened up the doors of their economy, and all of the capital went rushing out, destroying these nations. That's free trade. The next transparency, please. You can see the change in control by foreigners of bank assets in the countries. The first one is Argentina. From 1992 to 1997, it grew from about 15% foreign ownership up to about 51%. Chile from 16% to 52%. Mexico, back in 1992, there was only one foreign bank operating in Mexico, Citibank, with 1.5% of the total assets. That's why. That's the real invisible empire. You can't see it there. Nothing. But now, close to 60%, 59%. And again, you can see Brazil. They have not yet done to Brazil what they have done to the rest of the continent. Now, of course, the question that always comes up, and especially so in Ibero-America, is, well, who's behind this foreign takeover? Well, it's obvious. Wall Street, right? Wrong. Next transparency. These are the top 10 financial groups in all of Ibero-America by size of control of assets. The largest single financial group is the Brazilian state. They control $207 billion in assets in their banking system. The Brazilian government, the state, that's about a fifth of the whole continent, which is $1 trillion. And if you then look down the line, the second largest banking group in all of Ibero-America is the Hong Kong and Shanghai Banking Corporation, controlling $46 billion in assets. In July of 1995, they controlled nothing. They weren't there. Now they're all over the place. They run the third largest bank in Mexico. They move big into Brazil. They've got huge holdings in Chile, in Argentina, all over. Hong Shang, it's the lead bank of the drug trade. You have them taking over the banking system of Ibero-America, and you better watch American ghettos and suburbs, because that's what that means. It's drugs, it's marijuana, it's cocaine, and it's a new heroin boom coming into the United States. And I'll just state this parenthetically because there won't be time to develop it. What is happening now with heroin is what George Bush did 10 years ago with cocaine, crack cocaine. Remember our expose on that? George Bush brought crack cocaine into the United States, cheap, standard marketing technique, lowered the price to increase the consumption. That is now happening with heroin. 75-80% of the heroin coming into the United States that the captures are made on this is coming from Colombia. Not Southeast Asia, Colombia. And the standard purity of heroin in the past was 17%, 18%, really bad stuff was 22%. What do you think the purity of the heroin is coming in from Colombia today? It's 90%. That means that it can be smoked rather than injected. That means the stigma associated with a junkie who shoots up heroin all the time, according to the marketers of this, is no longer a problem to the expansion of their new commodity, inhalable heroin. And it's spreading today in the United States. Today, right now, it's spreading today the way George Bush spread crack in the ghettos of the United States in the mid-1980s. That's what it means when you have Hong Shang being the second largest bank in Ibero-America. And you can see looking down the line that of the top 10, six are British. Hong Shang, Banco Santander of Spain. There are three very large Spanish banks in Ibero-America. Santander, the BBV, Banco Bilbao y Vizcaya, BCH, Banco Central Hispano, they're totally run by the British. If you don't believe me, read the latest EIR, it's documented. So it's completely run by the British, Bank of Montreal, Scotiabank, and so on and so forth. Where is Wall Street? Well, let's take a look at the next transparency. There is Wall Street, in the dust. Hong Shang, Santander, Montreal, Bilbao Vizcaya, Central Hispano, and Scotiabank. All British, all way ahead of Citibank. Citibank is the otherwise the largest, approximately $16 billion in assets. Don't get me wrong, Citibank is very big, very bad, very dangerous. They have branch offices in every country in Ibero-America, which the others have not yet replicated. Their policies stink, as do the policies of the Bank of Boston, but you can see who is actually taking over. That is the first part of the Africanization of Ibero-America. Linda?
Okay. Now, from the standpoint of the invisible empire, two factors have impelled them to unleash the evil that we've seen in East Africa in the last 3 years. First, the old style of IMF straight conditionalities policy had left the continent with nothing more to loot out of the actual population. Second is the collapse, ongoing collapse of the international monetary system itself. And beginning in 1995, we saw a rush of the largest financial interests into hard commodities. Now, a lot of these strategic minerals and commodities are in Africa. Transparency, please. This gives you an idea of its production, of the highest concentrations of production, not reserves, in Africa today. As of 1994, Africa provided the world with 37% of its chromium, 72.5% of its cobalt, 20% of its uranium, 81% of its platinum, 32% of its gold, and 45% of its diamonds. And this shows the concentration down the center of Africa there with the Great Rift Valley down on into the Republic of South Africa. Next. The key country for strategic minerals is Zaire. But after 1990, when the plug was pulled on Zaire, its production took a nosedive. In 1986, Zaire ranked fifth in the world in the production of copper and was first in the production of cobalt and second in diamonds. This production went drastically down, but now that Kabila has secured or attempted to secure Zaire for the bankers and the miners, the British Commonwealth mining companies, the idea is to open up some of these, probably not all, to renewed extraction and production, and thereby have a much firmer cartelized control of the strategic commodities worldwide. I'm not going to go through the extensive and documented, the detailed documentation that Richie Freeman provided in this Never Again, London's Genocide Against Africans, EIR special report, which showed exactly which companies and which British Commonwealth companies and how they interlink and how these companies came behind Kabila in order to seize particularly the whole eastern corridor of Zaire. Now, at the same time, in Ibero-America, this process was going on in a far more quieter way.
That's my cue. Okay. First transparency, please. The continent of Ibero-America is shown in this and the next chart, singling out Brazil, which is the second column, because Brazil plays the role in Ibero-America in terms of the presence of enormous amounts of raw materials, which is similar to the role that Zaire plays vis-a-vis Africa. There are differences, but on this point, Brazil is the powerhouse as Zaire is to Africa. These are the seven principal industrial base metals, bauxite, copper, iron ore, lead, nickel, tin, and zinc. If you take the entire output of a manufacturing economy, you will find that 70% by weight of all the products is from these seven base industrial metals, if you leave out cement and so forth, and if you leave out coal from the considerations, which are by weight very, very large. But these are absolutely essential to any industrial economy. Now, if you take a look at this in terms of production, and by the way, the percentages for reserves or deposits would actually probably be greater proportionally. But in terms of bauxite, 28%, copper, 32% for Ibero-America, tin, 28%, iron ore, 27%. Those four alone have more than a quarter of the entire world's production going on in Ibero-America. And in those cases, you can see that Brazil plays a very major role. In the case of iron ore, Brazil is the number one ranked producer in the world. In the case of tin, it's the number four producer, and so on. If you look at the next transparency, where we will see both precious metals, or a couple of precious metals listed, and also the strategic metals. The first two are precious metals, gold and silver. Silver is very important in Ibero-America, not so much Brazil, mainly Mexico, Peru. They're 41% of the world's silver comes from Ibero-America. 12% of the gold. This is misleading, simply because the actual current output is nothing compared to what it's going to be, because there has been a huge, as Linda said, relatively silent British invasion, or of Commonwealth mining companies, where that proportion, I'm quite sure, is going to be rising very significantly immediately ahead. In the strategic metals, these are the key elements required for advanced industrial production. You cannot produce strong steel without manganese. You need beryllium, columbium, tantalum, and other metals. And you can see that in the case of columbium, for example, Brazil has 86% of the world's production of columbium. It's the number one producer in the world. Manganese, number five, tantalum, number two. So Brazil, in this sense, is a very big powerhouse. Now, if you look at the next slide, and Joe, I think this is where I also need the African corresponding map. Sure. You can see that just as Linda indicated in the case of Africa, so too in Ibero-America, there has been an invasion of foreign mining. And just as in the case of banking, lo and behold, it's the same companies with the same policy who have moved into Africa, which means you better watch out. And we have indicated here on the Ibero-American map some of the major new mining sites which have been invested in or are being looted currently by the four major British Commonwealth mining companies, Anglo-American, Newmont Mining, Rio Tinto, previously Rio Tinto Zinc, and Barrick of George Bush, who's on the International Advisory Board. And you can see the kind of presence that principally these British companies have throughout the continent. I want to single out one in particular, which is the Barrick activity on the border between Argentina and Chile. That's placed on the border there because that is exactly where Barrick has holdings. It is a deposit of gold which runs to both sides of the border. And what Barrick is in the process of doing is promoting, that is to say, forcing legislation in the Congresses of both Chile and Argentina to effectively eliminate national sovereignty such that that mine can be mined cross-border with no considerations for what country it's in. So the entire legislation of the countries is being changed as per Barrick's specifications. And that gives you an idea of the way the British are operating in this situation. Now, the next transparency, please, shows you Brazil in particular. And we can put up Zaire on the left screen just so that you can keep that not only in your mind's eye, but in your visual eyes as well, to get some idea of these parallels that we're discussing. In the case of Brazil, the red dots are various different kinds of mineral deposits in the country. You saw from the previous chart the extensive amounts of activity that go on in Brazil. The area that is shaded in a light green, which says CVRD areas, is what I want to point out. CVRD is the Companhia Vale do Rio Doce. Now, before I tell you about that, I want to first give you some idea of what the dimensions of Brazil are. Brazil is a continent unto itself. It is gigantic. 50% of its national territory is under Amazon jungle forest. In other words, it's virtually unexplored. It is not known what the wealth, potential wealth there is. But in addition to this mineral wealth, Brazil is also a major industrial economy. It is the 10th largest economy in the world. It has approximately 160 million people, 50% of whom are black. This incidentally makes Brazil the second largest black nation, or the second largest black population in a nation in the world after Nigeria. And something which will perhaps surprise you, perhaps the next transparency can be placed, Richie. The map is drawn to scale. Don't believe me, ask John Segerson. He'll prove it to you. Brazil is larger than the continental United States. They were sort of angry when we got Alaska and Hawaii because they figured they'd been cheated out of being number one in the hemisphere. But you get some idea of what this is like. Now, these green areas that I was talking about, the CVRD areas, look at the one towards the south of the country. This is an area which is larger than the state of Texas. This is an area, that area of the country is a major area of activity of CVRD, Companhia Vale do Rio Doce. CVRD is the third largest mining company in the world. It is the largest in the Americas. It is the largest iron ore producer in the world. It has enormous activities in mining. It owns 2,000 kilometers of railroads. It has 37 ships, 6 ports, 11 steel plants, some in the country, some outside, 3 paper plants, and so on and so forth. CVRD was originally founded in the 1940s when the Vargas government of General Getulio Vargas, with backing, explicit signed backing from President Franklin Delano Roosevelt in the United States, these were the Vargas-Roosevelt agreements, the Brazilian government of Vargas took over a British mining company called Itabira Iron. They nationalized it and they made CVRD. And since then, that company has been the backbone of industrial development of Brazil. And it's, of course, of some significance and importance that this was done in coordination with the Roosevelt government in the United States, which provided some important support in this regard. Now, what's just happened is that in April of this year, Compañía Vale do Rio Doce was privatized to George Soros for a song, for absolutely nothing, a couple of billion bucks, nothing compared to what this company is actually worth. And that gives you some idea of the British mining taking over of Ibero-America along the similar lines as has occurred in Africa. Linda?
Okay. Now, when we talk about the Africanization of South America or of any other location, if we look at what's happened in East Africa, then we know that what we are truly talking about is a return on a far larger and more intense scale to the collapse of the 14th century and the Dark Ages of that time. First of all, we have the disintegration of government, where all normal government services cease except for tax collection and maintenance of a national army, which does not function as a national institution, but functions as a mercenary force. And this was seen in the whole conquering of Zaire and from Uganda and Burundi and Rwanda. And as you heard today, the fact that all of the money that comes into the martyr lord countries is then siphoned off for the military for this purpose, so that the military operates directly against the interests of its own population. Then there's also the use of official mercenary forces as simply privatized warlord forces, which are in conjunction often with oversight from the British mercenary houses of Executive Outcomes, Sandline International, and so forth. In Executive Outcomes, they have a whole large franchise in northern Uganda, which unfortunately for them, they are not able to actually access because people still do live there. And in Sierra Leone, when they came in behind the government against the Revolutionary United Front for their services, they just simply demanded the entire nation's diamond franchise. So that the mercenary force comes in not as even a force for hire, but takes in and encroaches and takes away any form of national territorial sovereignty. And then also there's the eradication of borders. In Africa, because of the vast use or imposition at the point of independence by Prince Philip and the World Wildlife Fund of the reserve park system, already 8% of the entire landmass of Africa have been given over to national parks. Most of these parks straddle borders, and most of these parks have been used traditionally for years as the point, as the safe havens for guerrilla groups, which then maraud either side of the border at will from the safe haven of these parks. So borders, ever since independence, have always been had a vague existence within Africa itself. But now we see something different. Now we see something where borders simply no longer exist at all. And the linchpin in this operation, of course, is Ugandan President Yoweri Museveni. Can we have the first? Here he is as he is being sworn in on January 1st, 1986. And I want to put to rest, absolutely, I hope today, any idea that this person that his primary sponsorship comes from the United States. He was placed into power by the British, he's been maintained in power by the British, and that remains the case up to today. But let's go back to the very beginning. Next. This is the Evening Standard newspaper of December 14, 1986, where it says that Britain will take up the case of Uganda to the IMF. It says that extensive talks between Museveni and Baroness Linda Chalker, Minister of Overseas Development, resulted in the decision also that Britain would begin training Ugandan troops and begin arming Uganda. A senior British Army officer was to be attached to the High Commission in Kampala. Now, it is at this point that Museveni's National Resistance Army, which came in with at most 10,000 people into Kampala in 1986, and probably many of those under the age of 15, it is at this point that the National Resistance Army moves from 10,000 up to 100,000 troops in Uganda, sustained by a Ugandan economy that has already been decimated by years of Idi Amin and civil war. The article ends that after Mrs. Chalker's first encounter with President Museveni last February, his recent visit to London, and her return visit, it is clear that Britain is more than ever identified with the Museveni government. That is 1986. Next. The support continued in April 2, 1993. We see this headline, Britain defends NRM politics. Go home, Douglas Hurd tells exiles in UK. Next. I saved the best for last here. This is Chalker finds her great black hope. Uganda bewitched by British ally. This is the Sunday Telegraph of June 30th, 1991. The story here is kind of funny and gives you an indication of just how totally corrupt all this is. You see that little plane down there? Well, Linda and Yoweri were in it. And it dropped to the ground unexpectedly, and they were on their way to visit their joint venture of Karamoja gold mine in the northern Uganda. And that's the story here. So in point of fact, there should be no doubt that Museveni is a martyr lord force on behalf of these British interests. Next. The current Minister of State for Defense of Uganda, Mr. Mumbazi, was in Sweden in 1989, and he gave an indication of how what the British want to do, which is to eradicate the nation state completely in Africa, has found its perfect vehicle in the national resistance movement of Museveni, or in this so-called revolution that is taking over Africa. Because Mbazi told a group of Kenyan dissidents in Sweden in 1989, quote, the national resistance movement revolution has no boundaries. He says to arrive at a new Kenya, all patriots, youths, men, women, workers, peasants, intellectuals, and all honest countrymen must assume their respective duties and responsibilities in the political, military struggles of the people. All must learn the science and the art of people's war to acquire the necessary skills to disarm the enemy. All must learn how to organize and train for war, plan for war, and manage or direct war. All must assist and contribute to progressively build a People's Liberation Army. And of course, this is what began immediately for the next year, 1990. So here we have Uganda of 1986. We're going to just see the spreading ink blot quickly. Next. In 1994, we can add Eritrea, which came under the British tutelage, Rwanda, which was invaded and taken over by the Ugandan army, and Burundi, which succeeded in defeating the national elected government of the first Hutu president, Melchior Ndadaye. Next. In 1995, Ethiopia joins the group, having succumbed finally to pressure to move against Sudan. Next. Mozambique joins the British Commonwealth. Next. And here we have the gigantic leap forward of 1997, when Zaire comes under it. Sudan is invaded both from the east and from the south, and this is carried out by region-wide military force of combined troops of Uganda, Rwanda, Burundi, Zaire, Zambia, Angola, with aid from South Africa, arms from South Africa. Next. And then we have, this gives you an idea of Museveni's totally self-conscious understanding of exactly what he's doing when he says that his mission is to see Eritrea, Ethiopia, Sudan, Uganda, Kenya, Tanzania, Rwanda, Burundi, and Zaire to become one nation. And then he likens this to Hitler and says, as Hitler did to bring together Germany, we should also do it here. Hitler was a smart guy, but I think he went a bit too far by wanting to conquer the whole world. Next. This plan was put forward at the 7th Pan-African Congress that was held in Kampala, Uganda, April 4th to 8th in Kampala, Uganda, precisely at the point that 20% of the Ugandan army was moving into Rwanda for the final takeover of that country. This is a picture of Africa today. Next. The plan put forward by Arthur S. Gakwindi, today the deputy ambassador to Ethiopia with special responsibility to the OAU, shows that according to the Pan-Africanists, which is Museveni's movement, or he has taken over this movement right now, that this is what Africa would look like under that plan. Next. And then here we have the what it actually looks like on an overlay of Africa today. Now, it's interesting, for example, that this Swahili Republic, well, west of the eastern, very eastern part of Zaire, nobody speaks Swahili. So it'll be interesting to see how this is imposed, but already English is being imposed on Zaire and on Rwanda and Burundi. Gakwindi motivated this by saying the breakdown of central authority in Somalia and Liberia, the destructive civil wars that have crippled Angola, Mozambique, and Chad, the threats of secession in Sudan and Zaire, as well as the ethnic tensions that abound in many states on the continent, all call for the reevaluation of the viability of post-colonial African states and the sanctity of their borders. Next. And here we have the situation of the Marcher Lords and their auxiliaries. The Marcher Lords are in the currently, because now Kabila will become a Marcher Lord. And in fact, there's an article in the recent Ugandan newspaper that Kabila is poised to go into Uganda against Ugandan insurgencies in western Uganda, so that this is going to be a kind of free-for-all regional force deployed anywhere at will, which will include Zaire now. And then the auxiliaries, particularly South Africa, which said that it was, is now arming Rwanda and these Marcher Lord forces. The African National Congress very unfortunately put out a statement in defense of this by saying that Rwanda is a force for stability in the region. Next. And now we see the next targets of this, which is Kenya, which we've read about in the news. This is an extremely dangerous situation. And this, the Kenyan situation shows really the truth of statements that were made by people in Uganda this past spring, May, where they said, we're sitting on a tinderbox. And one would think, well, what more could possibly happen? But if President Moi is brought down under the current type of configuration of violence and insurgencies, which have been heavily penetrated from Uganda, and with a completely fractured and splintered opposition, then what we are very likely to see in Kenya is total chaos, a situation of total chaos and violence, which will, of course, radiate outward. So this is an extremely dangerous operation which is being carried out against Kenya right now. And then we have Congo Brazzaville, and also the countries over in West Africa, Liberia, Sierra Leone. All right. Next. Now, what is the cost to eradicate borders? Well, it costs a lot of lives. And in the case here, I'll just go through this briefly. We have Rwanda of 1990, the initial invasion from Uganda, which likely resulted in 200,000 deaths. In Burundi, in 1993, there was when President Ndiaye was murdered brutally, and his in an attempted coup, there were 100,000 people were killed in Burundi at that time in October of 1993. And since then, another 210,000 have died inside Burundi as the international community has continued to watch. There are also 800,000 people in concentration camps in Burundi right now who are dying of typhoid and hunger. In Rwanda in 1994, the bloodletting at that time was very likely, in that protracted spring, early summer period of 1994, was probably in the range of 1 million people. In Goma, at least 200,000 people died of cholera before the US Army got there. In Rwanda, multiple sources of Rwandans and others indicate that between 1994 and 1997, 1 million people have been killed in Rwanda itself, within Kagame's purview. Rwandan President Bizimungu said, "We are killing people, but these are the people who carried out the genocide in 1994. In eastern Zaire, at least 500,000 refugees were killed, and Zaireans, both Rwandan, Burundian, and Zairean refugees were killed in the process of the War of Liberation of 1996-97. And then if we take the entire Sudan War since 1983 and the dislocation that has caused, the death by killings and also by starvation, due to the inability to cultivate, we have another 1 million people over that 14-year span. And in Uganda itself, actually, this should read by from 1983, when Museveni carried out the genocide in the Luwero Triangle, at least 1 million Ugandans have been killed inside Uganda in that period. So what we have, mostly in the period of the 1990s, is a total of 5,210,000 people dead in this East Africa area alone. And I would say that this is really a conservative estimate. Next. The fact is that nobody can say they don't know about it. We have here a picture of the Rwandan refugees being forcibly repatriated at the point that the atrocities became known. In the end of May and June. If you look carefully at the picture, you'll see there's no young children in it, because most of the young children of these refugees had already died. I want to point out that the statements by Paul Kagame in the recent past of the Washington Post, that he in fact did carry out this genocide and would do it again. And then in a subsequent interview with the Mail and Guardian, he was asked, "Why did you say such a thing?" And he said, "Well, I don't like to lie all the time." On the one hand, this is an exposure of what has happened. But on the other, you have to consider the fact that this man has admitted to mass murder and gotten away with it. Nobody has called him to account yet. And this is the type of passive complicity which can be induced by the mass media if Paul Kagame and these people are not called to account. Then in point of fact, we are complicit in the murder that has occurred. So this is what it costs in just one small area of the world to eradicate the nation state. Dennis.
The process of nation state eradication, or erasing borders, which is what the British are involved in at this point, is perhaps in one sense less advanced in Ibero-America than the situation in Africa. As you've seen, the end result of that, I think, is captured most forcefully in that picture of the boxcars, which no one can possibly miss the point that this did happen before in history. It was run by the same people who were running this, the British. That there was Nazi genocide carried out in the past, which America once mobilized to stop. And had we not so mobilized, the world would not be here today. That same type of genocide, only worse, is being carried out by the same people all over again. And unless we again so mobilize, it will not be stopped. Now, this eradication of the nation state, the erasing of borders, is not simply a question of redrawing a map. You're talking about replacing the nation state with terra incognita, with no man's land, with an area of rampaging armies on both sides, both controlled by the British. And this is how the British are operating. They're doing this in Ibero-America in a very visible fashion, and it's the exact same people that Linda just described in Africa. In one sense, the nation state is more firmly rooted historically in Ibero-America for a series of historical reasons. Most of the modern nations were created in the early part of the 19th century. There is a strong and important current in Ibero-America coming from the evangelization of the Americas, which was a tremendous European project, which established a basis culturally and so forth, and with the concept of man, which we'll get to in a minute, which made it possible for such nation states to exist. And at most points, if not all points, where these forces of republicanism and the nation state flourished in Ibero-America, it was along with and in coordination with similar republican-oriented forces in the United States, which today are represented by the LaRouche movement. There's a historical tradition on this. It is that which is now being submitted to the British eraser, what they're trying to get rid of. Now, the way the British work in this regard, and it's very evident, for example, in a case like Colombia, is first they finance and create narco-terrorist armies, supposedly of the left. They're behind the drug trade. They are behind, jump the gun on me a little bit, but that's all right. It's okay, leave it up. They financed terrorism, they financed the drug trade on the one side, and they create leftist armies such as the FARC in Colombia, such as the ELN and so forth. Then the same British interests have promoted a policy of destroying the national military forces of the countries of Ibero-America, what we have called the complot, the plot to annihilate the armed forces in the nation states of Ibero-America. This plan comes from the British. It's run from Anglophile centers in Washington, such as the Inter-American Dialogue, infected areas of the Pentagon, the State Department, and so forth, who are deliberately taking down the capability of the nation's armed forces to fight against the narco-terrorists which the British have created. So first they build the narco-terrorists, then they take down a country's ability to fight against it, and they say, we have the answer for you. Why, we happen to have some private mercenary forces, which we will hire out to you so that you can fight the narco-terrorists who we also created.